when I was preparing to get my born son, Charles Theodore Abram IV, who works at the Hollywood Fort Lauderdale Airport, well, all we did last year was pressure cleaning, and it made that Victorian love seat and couch look a little newer. The message I have for you today is one that is very familiar, and it's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So if you're going to have this everlasting life, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to use your life as a service to others? Or are you going to be a loner, as if you were on an island, to do things just for yourself? Or are you going to help your neighbors, love your neighbors as you love by yourself, love the children in the community? Because it's my belief that the Bible teaches us, and we're in the library, and the Bible is a book, and it is a holy book. It teaches us to love, to care, and to share. So as I leave with you this melody, because I love to sing. As an educator, right now I am in the primary grades, so I just enjoy singing. So God, for God, so love.
So profound, and there's two things him when you ask and what you need.
Okay.
That's the same way God is when we pray for forgiveness. That's the same way when we have a me time with God. God don't look down on you on what you did. All he wanna know is where you at and what you need. I mean, what type of grace you need today? What type of mercy? Well, we know mercy is not free. Grace is free again. So my speech is universal. What a mighty God we serve.
Hallelujah.
And I take that and translate that into a connected friendship.
Mm-hmm.
Connected friendship. I was looking at my phone the other night and I was thinking a little earthly, and then I transformed the earth thought into a spirit.
All right.
How often we worry about this phone when the sales go down? First thing we look for is a chunk. It's desperation now. Even if we take care of something over there, we want to charge this phone up because we want that phone to be ready. But how do we think about our 2 a.m. friend that went to one of the time? How often we taking that spiritual cord and connecting with the Word of God? How often? See, the secular society has engulfed us so much that even the big boys, we're kind of losing our interest a little bit. You're losing that qualityness. Mm-hmm. You know, I like to add a word to the vocabulary sometimes. Qualityness. Mm-hmm. Each and every morning, I'm awakened. First thing I do is get a cup of coffee. Focus. And I venture out to the den. The view is so tropical. It can be Ethiopia, Brazil, Sudan, anywhere you need to be tropically. And then I sat there and meditated for a few minutes. And I wait for that one word. See, because you know, you do the OM sound. That was a training I had a long time ago. The OM is like the broom. And it's sweeping out that warehouse. You can't stop thoughts from coming in. I don't think there's no training to just have a roadblock to say which thought could come in. But the key element here is, what do you entertain?
Mm.
Okay, so I sat down. I said, okay, God. Sometimes, you know, he put me on the hold because he already know who he's dealing with. You know, he's searching before I got there. He allowed that guardian angel to say, "Wake Captain."
Mm-hmm.
I think about it. He said, "I don't really know what's on his mind this morning." But where I'm going with this is that once that one word make an impact inside that warehouse, that's how I do things. I get vital, I'm energized, I'm hyped up, and then I can't wait long. Because the mom will be calling from myself. You know, she's just as happy as I am. You know, and my lady Allison know that she's in them too. You know, they both are happy. But I look forward to it. It's inspiration, you know, it comes from all angles. I look forward to getting up. And then I know after I take care of time with God, I gotta take care of people.
Yes.
So you got to be prepared. You got to be instant in season and out of season. You got to have a word for somebody. Because I'll be honest about you, it's not all about you.
Right.
The person that you're talking to, and pretty soon all of these outreach here, all of them, they're going to have standing room on it.
Yes.
I like this setup. I'm going to talk to you about this later on. I can be moderate, you know, shoot that voice out there, it's getting great.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
My job is communication. I talk to so many people, that's why my voice is very tired today. But somebody I talked to today, this day,
yes,
to that phone. And I said, from all names, God set up certain things, certain things. And Lord, it's not about your cruise, ma'am. I said, I'm cruise. It's not about your cruise. It's about you today. How you doing?
Mm-hmm.
And prophetically,
where you get that from?
You know, I make sure the word out there.
How do you feel about this? Well, that's what I was just thinking about.
I had this one lady, she lived in Mobile. I went to minister. She spent $1,300 of the pass away. And she sat out there on the phone. So we talked on Friday night. She was like, Calvin, it's about 75 years. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, well, I'm not coming. I lost my husband and oh God. Because you know we had to build a rapport over a period. I said, now Miss Bill. My daughter said, man, yeah, she's 55 years old. I'm just, you know, country, you know, I'm gonna get it done. I'm gonna get everything. I don't wanna come down there. I'm good on my 10 acre farm. I said, no, you're not. I said, first of all, you're gonna hold up. Now I said, Miss Angela's been going how long? About 8 years. I said, okay. I said, now, you don't want him. Do you think that he don't want you to come? She got a question. I ain't coming. I'm going to just get away from my daughter. I said, no, you come. Mm-hmm. Now you got a separate space. You can bring somebody else, but she can come with you, but you're not going to transfer this package. You can come. But to make a long story short, we talked for about 45 minutes. And it's safe to say she came down.
All right.
See, that means more to Calvin Dutton. Because it was probably one of two words that inspired out. Maybe when I told her that, I said, spirit is inside of you. Mm-hmm. That's inspiration.
Yes.
I say, I want you to come up and have a little fun. God, where you going when you leave here? You going right back to him? But I'm just saying, you took, and you know, it's like God. God is very methodical sometimes. He do what he have to do to get your attention.
Yes.
That's inspiration. You got to be able to feel this thing. I can feel the spirit inside of me because I get hyped.
Hey.
I get hyped. Another night, I told her she came to pick me up. What, I spent an hour with this guy in hospice, right? $1,200 he spent with Calvin. I said, I've only been in there. It was Friday night. I could have rushed him off the phone, trying to make commission, but it wasn't about the commission with Calvin. Mm-hmm. And we were busy that night. I took 45 minutes of our time. And we stirred it up in a cup. And you know what he told me when we finished talking? He said, now I'm ready for my journey. Remember I said inspiration from all angles?
Yes.
When she came to pick me up, I had tears in my eyes. I wasn't even thinking about the $200 of something that I missed that I could have made. My whole makings were evolved around building a comfort zone for my friend. My message tonight is from any angle, how can you inspire someone?
All right.
Any angle. Mm-hmm. All you have to do is plant a seed. Mm-hmm. I'm speaking the same way that if it was people lined up all the way down to 441, I speak that way. Because I see all this filled up.
Oh, yes.
That's the way I speak. That's the way you have to speak. Can you see the spirit working from all angles? I do. I wasn't prepared to speak like this. I just knew once I got up here, I had to give it to you. My name is Calvin Dudley, and I'm just inspirational.
Here I am, you know, and I just thank God. So what I have to share with you, I believe he wants you to. You know, oftentimes we kind of think and we categorize people, and we think, okay, I think this person would be a good person to be saved, or maybe that person would be a good person to be saved. Or we categorize and say who it is should be saved, or who God should give this amount of grace to, or this ability to, and all of that. And so I said, okay, but whosoever will let him come. And we think that, okay, that righteousness of God, then I gotta be perfect. I gotta have it all together before I can go to God, before I can do God's service. Mm-hmm. And it was just this message that came about. You know, and the type of person, just think about it, the type of person Paul was. He was out there crucifying the Christians. I mean, he was a jailer. He was a person that we as a Christian would think would be the scum of the earth as far as who God, of course, would save a person like that.
May I have your attention, please? The library will close in 30 minutes. If you need to call for a ride home, please see reference staff now. Money transactions will end in 20 minutes. Fast services will end in 15 minutes. Computers will shut down in 15 minutes. Now is the time to save or print your work. If you would like to apply for a library card, please do so at this time. Library cards will not be issued after 7:45. No materials will be checked out after closing.
So anyway, I was just putting down some of these notes specifically about, you know, the type of person Paul was. And I said, wow, you know, God takes the weak. He takes those that are base. He takes the nothing. He doesn't take the high and mighty. Now, ooh, I got it all together. He doesn't take those people. And I thought about it. I said, wow, within our heart, we have to always have that humility.
Yes.
We always have to have that, like, childlike faith, you know? And I said, okay, he called the things that were abased, you know? And then when we think about, I mean, how worthy were we when we were called? Hmm. What were we doing when he just snatched us out? And I think about my own life, and I think about, okay, Kelly, so my God. We went to church, and we, you know, I used to walk home, you know, Dad would take us to church, and we'd be sitting there, and I would, it was just not of me, it was not a part of me, I was doing my own thing, until the word kept going in and in, the seed kept growing and growing, and who would have ever thought that at FAMU, God would have saved me? You know, so FAMU campus, I was going to sit doing my own thing. I was going to run for Miss Bam, do that year, and all this stuff. And then suddenly, my friend who was all, you know, she had it all together, and I'm like, "What happened to you?" And she said, "Girl, the Lord touched me." I'm like, "What you talking about?" And she said, "Come on and go with me to service that night." And I went with her to service that night. And I was like, okay. And she said, "Come on up and you know, give your life to the Lord. And this is what you say." And, you know, and all this kind of stuff. I'm like, right. So I went up there and I went through the motion.
Okay.
But little did I know, out of my mouth, I was making that profession of faith.
Yes.
And I would tell you, when I got home, I didn't think anything of it. I was going into my own little thing. Until suddenly, I went into this, it was almost like a trance kind of thing. I saw all these different animals. I mean, they were interesting enough. They were all kind of animals and stuff. It was almost like a vision. I was lying down, these animals, I was hearing these things about, things being